He plays Bob.
It's John Benjamin. John Benjamin.
Ladies and gentlemen, he plays Linda. It's John Roberts. He plays a 13-year-old girl, and he is one in real life. Bandits! She plays Louise. It's Kristen Schaal! He plays Gene. It's Eugene Merman! He plays the handyman, Teddy. It's Larry Murphy. He plays himself. He is the Papa Bear of the television program Bob's Burgers. It's Jim Daughtry. I'm Lauren Bouchard. We are so glad to be back here. How many of you were here the first year we were here?
I feel like that's impossible.
It was an act of faith. You came like, before the show was on the air. Am I right?
It's like 40 people.
It's possible, right?
A really small room.
How many of you were here last year? Which is better so far? We have a lot to talk about. Obviously, I want to get the actors talking as much as possible. But first, I want to say thank you, everybody, for buying the Bob's Burgers Burger Book. That thing was did not have to exist. That was not a crass merchandising thing. That was, we were making burgers of the day. They were funny jokes. Sometimes you guys come up to the microphone at Comic-Con and ask us what our favorite burger of the day is. Sometimes we are able to remember a single burger of the day, which is a great feat for all of us, because they go by in a blur. You have to understand what it's like. There's so many of them. But one man was making them. Cole Bowden, who's here tonight somewhere, was making the burgers for real. That means he had to invent the ingredients and the exact proportions, because we just made a joke. Those burgers were just puns, and but he made them real, and then we got to put them into a cookbook thanks to Rizzoli. I'm sure not Rizzoli, not Cole, and certainly not us expected quite so many of you to buy the book, but we really appreciate it. And if you haven't checked it out, I'm not pushing, I'm not selling, but I will tell you, they are all edible. Every single burger in there you can eat safely.
Except for one.
And we're not going to tell you which one it is.
Yeah, it's a secret.
I also want to tell you, Rizzoli just showed me the first coloring, the first, like, proof of the Bob's Burgers coloring book. Are you guys part of this coloring book revival thing that's going on? Even if you're not, can I just say, even if you're not, you might enjoy the Bob's Burgers coloring book. I think it just is a nice piece of Bob's Burgers art collected in one place. It is largely our script covers, which we do just for ourselves. They are never used on the shows, and they're often just sort of an inside joke, but they're in a coloring book. It's an outside joke. I want to say one other thing. All of you who've been here before, and the cast certainly have heard me say this, we really, truly are releasing the Bob's Burgers album. I know I've said it every year, but I want to say it officially from this podium for the last time, because the next time we come here, you'll all have it in your hot little hands if that's something that you are interested in. It is coming out early December of this year on Sub Pop Records, 107 songs from the show. It's our opus. Comes out to about 3 minutes of music. All right, this is our opportunity to get you guys to hear these guys talk about their craft, their characters, and the show. What I'd like to do to kick it off is to talk a little bit about something that has been on my mind lately, which is the fact that this show is animated makes it, for me, a great pleasure because I'm perfectly suited to work in animation. It's a control freak's medium. I get to decide ultimately when they smile or when they don't, whether their eyebrows go a little bit higher on that line or not. I think of it as live action. I like to say, I don't even know if this joke makes sense, but live action is just low budget animation because they hire actors to play the drawings. Kristen is my intention.
Benjamin was making fun of me.
I was not.
Oh, John's making fun of me.
I wasn't. I was just looking at you.
No, we were having a thing. It had nothing to do with you.
Oh, okay.
I was yawning.
Unrelated.
She did, yeah. You really yawned.
Yeah, when I yawn, I commit.
Huge yawn.
And I was just letting my lion yawn roar.
Right, sure. Yeah.
But I didn't know you were watching.
No. I know. I can see it on a big screen behind.
Oh, really?
It's never a good feeling when someone who's speaking sees a huge yawn in the background.
It doesn't mean I'm bored. It's just I need more oxygen.
Right.
Because I'm so excited.
Yeah.
You were talking about animation?
Yeah, let's do it. Let's kick it out. Kristen, let me start with you. I'm going to go out of order. This is, you work in live action animation, both, in fact, for the same network, lately, among other things. What's your experience? How are they different for you?
Sorry. Oh, my God.
One of the things, okay.
Yeah, now you get it.
It hurts. It hurts. Yeah,
well,
sorry.
Taste to your own medicine.
It's like, ouch. Like what? Like everything I'm about to say is invalidated. But I will say, when I do Bob's Burgers, it doesn't feel like work to me. Like I'll always be like, oh, I don't have any work this week, and my husband will be like, well, you're doing Bob's like Wednesday and Friday, and I'm like, oh, right, but that's not work. You know, like it doesn't feel like a job. Whereas when I'm doing live action, like Last Man, you know, it's like, well, I'm working because I'm in, yay! It's a longer day. It's like a 15-hour day, and it's just a lot. It's like more because I can just relax and just be Louise, and then Lauren will suffer the hardship of making her expressions just right. But when I do live action, I'm like, that's up to me. Like, I gotta control this face. So it's like, double work. But that's the difference. But I enjoy them both. And I would say it's more fun to watch Bob's Burgers because I'm not looking at myself.
Eugene, say what you were saying backstage about the difference for you. Animation versus live action.
I think one of the great things about animation is, you're all listening.
Yeah, this is your moment.
Okay, let me tell you. It's that, you know, we do the script as written, but then we also get to improvise. And the truth is, we can improvise as much as we want, and you use what works, so there's really, you can't fail. You can do stuff that's not funny, but only like 19 people know about it. And then when you cut it all together and it's a good time.
So, yeah, you were saying that it encourages bravery.
It encourages bravery because you can take chances and you can't fail in the same way that I guess theater can fail. I don't know. I guess you can take chances with live. It's also like quicker. You can just sort of joke around and reset much faster in animation.
Right.
But that doesn't work for everybody.
Well. Everybody, yeah, animation
really encourages bravery to some people.
Oh, yeah.
I
could improvise.
Too much and not fun.
John Roberts, what about you? What's your experience working in animation versus live action?
It's great. Only because I only have an animated job, but.
Never done live action.
And I probably will never know the joys of live action.
We'll compare live action to YouTube.
Yeah, no. One thing I do like is that you can hide behind an animated character a little bit and the audience doesn't get as sick as they would as if they were looking at my face or any human's face, really. I think it's nice that animation kind of has that timeless, you know, that timeless thing going on.
How about you, Dan?
I'll just answer for Dan.
What I like about animation is that you can just keep rewriting it so much during the process. When you shoot live action and then you write the script and then you shoot it and you get a cut and you're like, oh, that didn't work, we wrote it, but you kind of are stuck with it and have to edit around it. And with animation, you can just rewrite half the script, which you often do.
Yeah, that's right. Dan, by the way, you don't know, might not know, is a writer, in addition to a voiceover actor, and he's been writing on live action, more than one live action show this year, is that correct? Mm-hmm. Some sort. And Veep?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, wow.
You're absolutely right. We get to work and work on the thing. We rewrite so many times in animation, and particularly for animation for Fox, where we have longer budgets than we might on cable, and it's a real pleasure if you like rewriting, which, yeah, most, I think, writers do. Larry, what about you?
Oh, I think everyone kind of covered it. I mean, as far as what Eugene said, it's definitely true, but I would compare not just the animation, but the animation making Bob's, in that you allow us to burn a lot of tape.
Yeah.
We waste a lot of time making Bob's, tons of time.
There is a lot of goofing around.
Yeah, there's a ton.
You think it's fun to hang out with us? You're right.
I don't know if you guys had a chance to watch the Bob's Burgers live trailer movie.
The one that you directed?
No big deal. But these guys were acting in it, and they should all be in front of the camera, in my opinion.
I agree.
Not a popular opinion, but...
Yeah.
Not yet. Jim, how about you? You have mostly worked in animation, but you have dabbled in live action. What was your experience?
I have. I was thinking, animation is much more forgiving in terms of, as they say, we can revise for 8 or 9 months and correct our mistakes. But casting, I think, is one of the cool things about it, because obviously we can be gender benders. You know, we can have Dan play.
I'm a boy.
Yes, you are.
But we can also, you know, John Roberts can play Linda, and he can also play Jocelyn. You know, Dave Herman can be Mr. Frond, and half a dozen other characters that we need. Larry can be Gretchen, you know, as well as Teddy. So it gives you so much more.
Like, all the men can play women, and it's just
we wonderful.
Saren.
Yeah, well, you got to work on your guy character.
Hey, well, Pam Adlin, I'm pretty sure she won an Emmy for playing Bobby on King of the Hill, right?
Yeah.
It was a female playing a boy character.
The Silverman.
Oh, wow, you nailed it.
What about you, John? What's your experience?
Pay scale is way worse in animation. And you get paid a lot more in live action, and so I lose.
My feeling is that there's all of these benefits for us working on it, and then I have a theory that there's a different experience for you watching it, that, you know, animation, I'm convinced, enters our brain in a different way. You know, it's these icons, and we sort of have to use a different part of our mind when we're watching it, and I'm hoping that it means we'll all be employed for a long time, that we're tricking you into liking this show using colorful drawings and moving them every once in a while. I have a theory that it's part of why we have a relationship with you people, that it's, you know, we're able to deliver this show through this very unique mechanism, but I don't know. We need any neurologists in the audience? Any neurologists?
100.
Yeah. 100. Just moving colorful shapes make people like you? Neurologists?
Anybody? That's from the last convention here. There was the neurology.
That's right. All right, let's show some clips. This, speaking of animation, We I think we have all color clips this year. I always like bringing animatic and even thumbnail boards around, but I think this year it's all color. Correct me if I'm wrong, Tony. He's not here. Janelle. We try to stay away from technology in the show, in a way. It's sort of retrograde. On some level, we kind of stay 5 to 10 years behind the times in terms of who's got a cell phone in the family and so on. But we did go right at technology in this particular episode where Tina twists her ankle and they send her virtually to school.
Edward Snowden?
Yes, exactly. Snowden did this in real life recently, but we did it on the show. This is Tina going to school basically as a robot. Take it away. Coming up, this fall, my Bob's Burgers. All right, this is that time. We want to hear from you. There are microphones. Be polite, be gentle, be kind. Line up. Looks like that's Mr. Man with a piece of paper.
Do not run.
Do not run. Oh, I know who this question's for.
Who?
It's Kristen.
Okay. Why? Is it a hat?
Big faux pas, John Benjamin. It's called Gravity Falls.
Yeah! Oh. I didn't know. I thought it was like from the Forestry Service.
This question is for Sasquatch?
Go ahead.
How is it for you to change from Mabel to Louise? Is it pretty easy or?
Well, it's easy now because Mabel no longer works. I don't know if you heard the show's over. But you can do the cipher hunt, #cipherhunt. I mean, you might be a little behind, but you should definitely catch up on it. There's a hidden treasure buried somewhere, and it's pretty cool. But I do miss Mabel.
You're there.
Oh, gotcha. Yes.
Oh, hello. I wanted to know the main inspiration for Tina and Louise. Did you guys take those two characters like from somebody that you knew personally or? Yeah.
Well, I would say Louise is sort of my inner child in a way, and like a nephew that I have that used to be a little bit cranky rolled into one.
What about you, Dan?
Yeah, I mean, I didn't write or create the character, so I can't take, you know, wasn't responsible for that much about her, but I feel like I definitely relate to being, that kind of quiet person, especially as a teenager. I mean, to talk exactly like her, so. what I brought to it is, I feel like early on, Tina had more just kind of like joke, weird lines that she said, and I kind of like knowing like that like you could have that very monotone exterior but have a lot of like strong emotions inside, and like still, and then that, you know, then they started giving her more like emotional story.
Dan has feelings.
Dan has feelings.
Yeah.
That's what I'm getting
just
from that.
Just admitted it.
Yeah. How's that? Who's next?
Just fair.
Hi, I have a question for Mr. Benjamin.
That's Mrs. Benjamin,
oh,
thank you.
Oh, sorry. Since you do the voice of both Bob and Archer, but they're essentially just your voice, how do you take a different spin to the character?
You make it sound like that's easy.
No, that's why I asked, because it seems
it's hard.
You're right. It's easy. It's terribly easy.
So sorry. What was the question?
Just how do you bring such a different spin to the characters? How do you make them each unique?
Well, they're so different. Characters to play. But the easy answer is Archer is really a confident character, and I think Bob is a little more tentative, more like me. It's easy to bark out every line as Archer. And all the lines that Archer says, it really does call for that. I can't even talk right now. But I guess hopefully they're a little different, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Sure they are.
That's
sure
the they first are. Time I think I've ever heard you be sincere. I like it.
I like it.
It's getting old.
Yeah.
Getting old.
There's a lot more of that. Where that came from.
What's the next question? Step right up.
It's such a musical show and it's awesome. How much of the music is improvised, if any? Because there's so many like tunes and random things that happen, especially for Glinda.
Yeah, that's a great question. John, talk about how you are sometimes asked to perform.
Yes, I always like to improvise songs because it's so much fun for me to try and come up with something. But these guys are so good at writing songs that it's also a thrill to come in and have a whole orchestration and everything already laid out. So it's a nice mix of stuff, but it's fun when you kind of think on your feet and it actually turns into something too.
It's like a jam session, you know, from like the jazz days and stuff.
Yeah, yeah, those days are over. No more jazz or order.
John, all the cast members I think have had this where dialogue from the show, sung or not, becomes a song by the time we get our hands on it and put it in the end credits. And a lot of the stuff, in particular, that John Roberts does as Linda is so, it's musical already, and then we just figure out what key was he singing in, and our very talented musicians put music behind those songs, and it's really fun. Now that we've been working on the album, I get to hear these songs over and over again, and they're infectious. Date night tonight.
Yeah. She's got the music in her.
Yeah, she does. How about Mr. Equestronaut? Let's hear a question from Bronconius. Look at that.
That is frightening.
You guys were talking about how it's fun to gender bend your performances, and I was wondering if you have a process by which you decide who's going to play a new female character and like whether it gets to be a male or a female actor.
Kristen, you want to take this?
Oh, I have no control over the casting.
I do it all.
Yeah, I figure you should answer that.
Oh, I thought Kristen was going to say, oh, I know how they do it. If you're a man, you can play a woman.
All of it.
Wow. Bob's Burgers. Yeah. We listen to the voice. Our goal is not to gender bend just for the sake of doing it, but to put the right voice in the right mouth. So we're always just listening to what we think people can do. Sometimes we straight up cheat. John Roberts was already doing that character. We just asked him if he would loan it to us for a little while. Jordan Peele was doing this wonderful cross-dressing character in a sketch on Key and Peele, and we asked him if he would do it for Fanny. So a lot of times it's just, you know, we're just listening. And you know, Larry, it was fun to find out that Gretchen would come out of Larry Murphy's mouth. That is just this girl straight out of South Boston, straight out of Larry.
Yeah, she sounds like this.
So for us, it's the pleasure, like Jim was saying earlier, the pleasure of the medium. We can do this, but of course, it's our job to do it well, do it right. It's not a stunt. We don't want to just have a dude's voice come out of a lady's body or vice versa, but actually just the right voice.
But me and Larry both grew up with lots of women, households filled with women, so I think we both have that kind of...
I know a lot of women who have grown up in households.
What's that? What?
She's back. She's back.
Yeah, she's back.
Get her some wine. Get her a rose.
There's gotta be someone up here.
A little too much.
Hey! Hey, Sub Pop! Nice shirt!
Yeah.
Thank you. My wife and I have different schedules. I work at night, she works at the day, so I come home, I put on...
Oh, another sob story.
Oh, dear.
Sorry you can't see her. Everybody
no, so
works.
I watched the episode where Bob, you know, he becomes a cab driver. He's looking up the skirt of the night, but I watch it with subtitles on because I don't want to keep her up. And the subtitles are very different. And I was wondering if anyone ever caught that disconnect before. And
oh,
if
that's
anyone,
funny.
Has anyone ever known where
we
Bob's
tried,
mother
we
comes
tried.
From?
No, we tried to get it right for closed captioning, but it is a service. There is somebody listening to the track, and I think occasionally the songs in particular are not written anywhere, so there's nothing for them to cross-check it against. There isn't necessarily a script. I mean, songs are written somewhere, but it's on a piece of paper with blood on it. and I think, yeah, we're printing out the lyrics for the album, and we gotta make sure we get those right. Lifting up the skirt of the night. Don't look down, feel around, doing what you do to get by.
Doing what you do to get by.
Pulling down the pants of the night. Don't laugh, it's all right to make fun of the
night.
Also, if you just do a couple bong hits, you won't notice the difference.
You do notice.
Okay. Well, Sativa.
Well done, sir.
Yes, what's your question?
Any plans to merchandise a Coochie Kopi nightlight in physical form?
Yes. Yes, there is. Here's the options we were presented with. One was to come out right now with one that plugs into the wall, or wait a little and get the Coochie Kopi nightlight that you can actually take to bed like we all want to. So we're doing that one. It's just taking a little longer to make it right. It's coming. Thank you for asking.
Do you think next year someone will come dressed as a Coochie Kopi with melted down
oven?
Oh, yeah.
Hopefully.
I'll see you next year.
That's a good one. It's a challenge. It's a challenge.
Challenge.
What's your question?
So, what's your favorite episode, in general, from all of you?
Lightning round. Quick, go.
Go.
Oh, wow.
Bob.
From Bob's Burgers or any show?
Yeah, I'm gonna say
this show.
Lord Supremacy.
Be the final battle.
I don't know. I mean, I do. I can't think of it now. Go down there.
Eat pretty, Linda.
Yeah. Eat spray, Linda.
Oh, sorry. Never mind. Sorry, John Schrader.
He doesn't even know the title of his favorite episode.
Eat pretty, spray, Linda.
Topsy? Is that what it's called?
Yeah, I feel like that one a lot.
OT, the outside toilet.
The deepening.
Crawl space.
That's the deepening.
What's the name of the math one?
Can't buy me math?
Can't buy me math.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Can't buy me math.
How about you, Jim?
From season one, I like Art Crawl and She's Kev Bob. And I also think the 100th episode, Glued Where's My Bob, was very nice.
Yeah. Wait, also Tina with the horse.
That was great.
That was
a great
horse rider.
Horse rider.
Thank you.
It's hard to pick one.
But we mentioned, I think, all of them. Every episode.
Hi, what's your question?
Hi, I love you guys all. Star Talk Radio is awesome. Tina and Gene have had love interests on the show. Louise hasn't. If she had, what would their personality be like?
Well, Louise, she's 9. There has been some speculation that Louise would be into Logan, voiced by Kurt Braunohler, who's also my comedy partner. There's been some fan art where Louise is aged up and they're just like getting it on. And it's a little difficult to see, but also it's sexy. I can see her with Logan. I can see her with regular size Rudy for sure.
Make sure you check out our Valentine's Day episode this year.
Yeah.
Bob actually is the name of it. We do this great kind of shoot around. I'll just say this, everyone gets a kiss.
Spoiler, big spoiler.
That was a teaser, that's technically a teaser.
I think you should forget you heard that.
Thanks. 5 minutes.
Hi, this is
to ask this question. So, talk really slowly.
That may be hard. I talk very fast.
Okay.
This question is, I guess, is for you, Ben, but it's for the entire cast. I know in Archer you did a spin-off of Bob's Burgers. I'm wondering, would you all have any interest, and what would your thoughts be on Bob's Burgers of doing, a sort of Archer spin-off?
Yeah, that's been asked a lot of Lauren. I think it was a really popular Archer episode. People really liked it because Bob's Burgers fans liked it and Archer fans liked it. So I, Lauren always sort of answers it that it's a little harder to do from our side, Bob's Burgers back, but I don't know.
Yeah, we'll figure it out. We gotta figure it out. It's clearly on your minds. We hear you. We know that the desire is there. We just want to do it right, and we haven't cracked it yet.
There's so many other crossovers to get to before, right?
Yeah, we gotta do the whole movies crossover. We're bad at crossovers. We enjoy when our characters show up in other TV shows, and we haven't figured out the right way to have a character from another world show up in our world. But
I think it started that the people who make Archer are huge Bob's Burgers fans, and it is not reciprocal.
Like, do you really want to see Archer up in Bob's Burgers business? I mean, I feel like you'd get enough of it.
Linda does. Yeah, Archer. Hi, Archer. You sound just like Bobby, huh? Yeah. Bye, Bobby.
Thanks for that question. Who's next? Is it Tina?
Hi. You've spoofed a lot of movies in your episodes, but with a twist, like E.T. being an outdoor toilet. So are there any other movies that you would like to spoof, or maybe can't do, or just what you would like to spoof?
Yes, we love doing the homage episodes. We came out right out of the gates kind of proudly proclaiming our love for some of the old farts, in particular, the like 70s films like The Shining and Dog Day Afternoon. But we are working our way through a lot of them, and it is a real pleasure. It gives us a kind of something to sink our teeth into, but it never feels like it breaks the world. It always feels like we can keep doing them. It's easier to run through the 20th Century Fox properties, I will have to admit. Greases the skids legally when we're doing a full-blown homage, and we're actually gonna like see some of the characters from the movies, like Work Hard, Die Trying was a mashup of two movies that happened to belong to the 20th and two movies we really wanted to fool around with. So in this, I wanna say either this spring or next fall, you will see, Aliens as imagined as a school play that never could exist. Tina's lying to her mother and telling her about the play that she missed. And Tina imagines herself as Ripley and Jocelyn as the alien queen. And then she adds a body switching story like Freaky Friday, and Ripley and the alien queen switch bodies, so they really understand each other.
Thank you.
You're an awesome Tina, sure. By the way. You're very blessed. Yeah. You're awesome.
And I'm hoping we do Ken Burns as the Roosevelt.
We have 1 minute. I'm so sorry.
An 8-hour special.
Gene, what's your question? You look fantastic.
Well, okay, thank you. So, I'm not sure if you have time for this. Maybe just do one. But would any of you guys mind trying to impersonate one of the other people's characters?
Wow, okay, wow. That's fun.
Okay.
Question?
I guess, Larry, take it away.
Yeah, go ahead, Larry.
Yeah, I think we've covered it. I think we're all set.
That was my best John Benjamin.
Yeah, I think we're good. Yeah.
That was great.
All right.
I got.
Yeah.
I don't know.
I got one.
I saw Roseanne with my love.
Now I know.
That's your best.
The character,
not Louise. Now I know
who that is.
Yeah, Kristen drinks a lot of rosé.
Someday you will too.
Louise, I think we have time for one more. Is that right, Louise? Give us your last question.
Okay. Hi. I was wondering if if the restaurant ever got more popular, do you think it would change the premise of the whole show?
Like if you won a James Beard Award?
If they got more,
you might not know it.
They became richer.
Like best chef of the Northwest?
Yes, the answer is yes, it would change it. We have to keep them perennially on the edge of either almost failing or almost succeeding, and we'll never let them go one way or the other. We are not going to Roseanne this.
Yeah, remember when Roseanne won the lottery?
That was a mistake.
terrible.
No, it's a story locked in a
stay
moment.
Struggling.
Yeah. They won the lottery in the last
year. Oh, that's right. Yeah.
Man, I thought you said
Rosé. We promise you that they will never
I think it's some.
What did you think?
I thought you said Rosé.
Oh, Rosé. Yeah. That was it. That's the show you watch.
I watch this
actually,
show
that's
Rosé.
The label you look at every
it's
night.
It's just so
all right, we got one.
Consistent.
We got a reprieve. We got a reprieve. Let's get one more in.
We got one more.
Yeah.
We only have time for everyone to go around the room and say their names, so let's start.
I'm guessing there's a lot of jobs.
We have the last question, and then we got to wrap it up really quick.
Just a question regarding the animation. I don't know if it's just a choice in it, but what is there a reason why there's a severe lack of chins in the universe?
What's so cool about chins?
Yeah, who needs them?
It's just
thank you for coming, everybody. Thank you.